Well, students, in the last class, we have seen what is meant by swap and how it works. In this class, we will see how to compute the swap rate. The first question is, what is swap rate? If you recall, in a swap, a borrower A swaps a random interest rate with a constant interest rate, right? That is a floating leg with a fixed leg. In other words, you have a cash flow of, say, at the first interest due date, you are supposed to pay the interest of V1, and second it is V2, and so on up till Vn, where each VI is different from the other, is finally swapped with a constant interest payment of, you know, minus S, minus S, and so on. Well, these V's are also negative because from the borrower's point of view, he is paying the interest. Therefore, it should be written as minus. Let Pn be the face value of the borrowed money. That is, the borrower A borrowed an amount of Pn from the bank V. Remember, this is bank V is the one which lent the money to the borrower with a variable interest rate, and bank F issued a swap through which borrower A got a fixed interest rate. Now, bank F has fixed the interest payment to rupees S, thereby it fixed the interest rate on the principal amount, right? Which is the notional principal, we call, as far as the deal between borrower A and bank F is concerned, Pn is the notional principal, and S is nothing but Rs into Pn, right? Where Rs is the fixed interest rate. Now, each payment is a period of, say, Tk minus 1 to Tk, right? This is the period. Okay, so initially it starts from t equal to 0 and every period is represented as tk minus 1 to tk. Okay, and generally, if right from the beginning, we always represent the interest rate to be per annum, that is annual interest rate. Therefore, we will also consider here Rs to be an annual interest rate. Thereby, you have to multiply this entire thing with a delta tk. What is delta tk? This is Tk minus Tk minus 1, right? So, the swap rate is actually this Rs. So, our question is how to compute Rs. So, let us represent the interest rate charged by the bank V in the period Tk minus 1 to Tk as Rk. That is, the period Tk minus 1 to Tk, the bank V, that is the one which is charging variable interest rate, has fixed your interest as Rk here, right? So similarly, from here to Tk plus 1, it has fixed the interest rate Rk plus 1, and so on this side, and similarly this side at Tk minus 2, the bank fixed the interest rate as Rk minus 1 and so on. Okay. Then per period, interest rate of the swap is, remember, the bank F, that is the bank which is issuing this swap, in order to convert the variable interest rate to a fixed interest rate, is actually going to pay only the difference between the its fixed interest rate and the interest rate charged by the variable bank at every timing, right? Therefore, what the bank F, that is the one which is issuing swap, is going to pay is Rk minus Rs. Okay, Rs is the one which is fixed here. Okay, when the bank F fixes the amount S to be paid, it is automatically fixing this Rs also. Okay, so that is coming from here. This, since we have per period, So you have to multiply it with the delta Tk, and that we will call as rho k. This should happen for every k right from the beginning till the end of the borrowing. So that means at every time t is equal to Tk, bank F pays rupees rho k into Pn to the borrower A, right? If rho is positive, then bank F has to pay to borrower A. If it is negative, then borrower A will compensate that gap by paying that difference to bank F. Okay, so this you have to clearly understand this concept. So therefore, this is the money that has been transacted between these two people, either paid by one to the other, depending on the sign of rho k. So the present value at t is equal to zero is given by, we'll denote it by PV of zero comma Tk, which is equal to a discount factor defined at Tk times rho k Pk. Okay, how to define this discount factor? Well, it depends on in what way the interest rate is calculated. Generally, you can fix some scheme, whether compound scheme or the continuous compound scheme. If it is a continuous compound scheme, e to exponential of minus sigma j equal to 1 to k rj delta tj. Similarly, if you are using the discrete compound case, you can do a similar formula. See, what is the idea of defining this? You can see that for the period tk minus 1 to tk, the payment done at this time in the swap is rho k pk, right? This is the amount transacted between borrower A and bank F in the swap of interest. Now, if you see the previous times, k minus 1 and so on, you go till t equal to 0. So for this period, what we are doing is we are discounting for this period by e to the power of rk into delta tk. And for this period, we are doing it for, there is a minus sign here, exponential of minus rk minus 1, that is k minus 2, that is established here, into delta tk minus 1. Like that, we are going. Okay, so at t1, it is exponential of minus t1 delta t1. Okay, so you have to discount from here to here and from here to here by the discount factor this, and from here to here by discount factor is similarly like that, and it goes on, and from here to here the discount factor is this. Okay, therefore your payment here, if you want to bring it to the initial, so if you are in this one, if you want to bring to the present value at t equal to zero, you have to basically discount it this many times the amount that has been transacted. Okay, so that is how you got this this amount. So rho k pk discounted till t equal to zero is what is the present value. Similarly, you can do it for discrete compounding also. The same idea you can follow. See, this happens only for, you see, this period. Okay, that is tk. Similarly, you have to discount for each period. Okay, and this side also. Tk plus 1 and so on. Till Tn, you have to discount the entire, everybody you have to discount up to here. Okay, so that's the idea. So you have therefore PV of zero, that is the present value of the cash flow in swap, is actually given by the sum of all these present values, k equal to 1 to n PV of 0 comma TK. Okay, so that's the final present value at t equal to 0. So one may interpret this present value as the price of the swap. This is the price that the borrower A has to pay in order to get the swap. But you see, swap is a non-contingent claim. It means both bank F and borrower A has the obligation to execute this swap at every time interval. Therefore, when both has this obligation, why should one of these two pay this amount to the other? Okay, this is the price that either borrower A or bank F has to pay. Okay, so there is ambiguity. Who will pay to the other? Okay, but it is a non-contingent claim. It means you generally don't have any value for the contract at the initial time. Okay, but swap does not have a payment at the initial time. Okay, so therefore, we have to have PV of 0 equal to 0. Okay, this is what we have to have. Okay, that will actually give you a value of RS, because you see, RKs are already fixed by somebody, bank F, who is no way related to this swap. Therefore, we cannot tweak RKs, right? We cannot manipulate the parameter RK because it is fixed by somebody else who is not in the swap. Similarly, the notional principle is also not a part of the swap. Therefore, we cannot tweak that also. So the only way that we can adjust is RS. So you adjust RS in order to get your PV to be equal to zero. Okay, that fixes the value of RS, and that is what is called the swap rate. Let us now see how to solve this equation to get RS. Recall how PV of 0 is given to us. PV of 0 is equal to sigma k equal to 1 to n PV of 0 comma TK. This thing. So how PV of 0 comma TKs are given? They are given by this. Sorry, there is a mistake here. This is N, not K. And similarly here also, it is PN. This is, okay, not K here. And here also you have a mistake. It is R1. Okay, please make these changes in your notes. So this is your PV of 0 comma TK. So we write them like this. D of 0 comma TK, that is the discount factor. It can be a continuous compounding discount factor or a discrete compounding discount factor, depending on what you choose. And then this is rho K PN, not K, PN. Now, since it doesn't depend on this index K, you can try take it out and write it as K is equal to 1 to n d of 0 comma tk and rho k. What is rho k? Rho k is nothing but delta tk into rk minus rs, right? So that I will just put it as pn into sigma k equal to 1 to n d of 0 tk delta tk or k minus sigma k equal to 1 to n d of 0 comma tk delta tk Rs that I will bring outside. So that is the second term. Okay. So now we want to make PB of 0 equal to 0. Right. So that implies our Rs, which is here, you can write Rs as, so Pn goes out because you always assume Pn to be non-zero because nobody will pay zero amount as a loan and then work on how they will take the interest, right? So there is no point considering the case when Pn is zero. Therefore, Pn is always positive, in fact. So it goes off. You have sigma k equal to 1 to n d of 0 comma tk delta tk or k divided by sigma k equal to 1 to n d of 0 comma tk into delta tk. So that is the formula for the swap rate. With this, we finished our discussion on swaps. Next, we will discuss about another derivative called futures. Future is a derivative that comes under the category of non-contingent claim. It is very much similar to the forward contracts. See, forward contracts are traded over the counter, whereas the futures are traded on exchanges. Both forward and future are contracts between two parties, say party A and party B, who fix a contract between each other on trading an underlying asset on a future date. Right? This idea is common to both the forwards and futures. But the difference is the party A and party B will get their contracts settled between each other through a mechanism called over-the-counter. Either they will have some broker in between and they contact each other through the broker and get this contract done, or they may have a direct contact between them on phone or email and get the contract set. Okay. Whereas future is different from the over-the-counter, means there is an exchange like NSE or BSE, that is National Stock Exchange or Bombay Stock Exchange in India. So this exchange will act as a mediator between these two people and make the contract between them. The advantage with this idea is that this exchange will act as a regulator, means the party or the party B cannot default the contract. Whereas in the forward, since it is done on a rather non-regulated manner, one of the party A or party B may default if the contract at the expiry is not favorable to them, right? But that risk, which is also called the credit risk or default risk, is not there in future at all. But otherwise, all the other mechanisms are the same. The underlying asset is set to a price called future price. In forward, we call it as forward price or also called strike price. Usually, we denote it by F of, at the time of the contract, the time is taken to be zero, and the expiration is generally denoted by T. If you recall, for the same parameter, we use the notation capital F comma T for forward. So that's one main difference between forward and future. Otherwise, their underlying idea is same. And another one important difference between forward and future is that the forward is settled at the expiry either by cash transaction or the asset transaction. Whereas in future, the settlements are done through a process called the marking to market concept. Okay, so let us try to understand what is mean by marking to market concept. So you have party A and party B. The underlying asset is quoted the rate F of 0 comma T, the expiration price or the future price. Now what the exchange does is collect some 10% of F of 0 comma T from party A, and similarly 10% of F of 0 comma T from party B. Okay. So this is called the margin deposit. So the exchange will keep the margin deposit collected from party A and party B. Generally, it will be between 5 to 10% depending on the liquidity in the underlying asset. Okay. So let's take it as 10%. Exchange collects this and keep it with it, called margin deposit. And at the time of the contract initiated, let us call this as T equal to zero. Now at the end of every day, okay, of course the strike price changes. In fact, it changes every moment during the trading time. At the, say, next day, say F of 1 comma capital T is the strike price of the future of the same asset on the same expiry date. Okay. Then what the exchange does is it takes the money F of 1 comma capital T, that is the closing price of the future contract, same future contract on the next day. Okay. It takes that price minus the price at which these two parties went for the contract. Okay, that is 0 comma T. This money will be given to party A. Suppose the party A is the long side of the contract and party B is the short side of the contract. Then this happens, and the same minus of that, that is F of 0 comma T minus F of 1 comma T, is put into this account of the party B's margin deposit account. Okay. This is on day one. Okay. On day zero, they both went for the contract, say at the market closing time. Contract initiated. Day one, these two happens. Okay. So if this is positive, it means this is negative, right? If this is positive, then this is negative. It means the money from margin deposit of part B is given to part A. Okay. If this is negative, then this is positive. It means that money from margin deposit of part A is taken and put in the margin deposit of party B. So this is how they do on the day one. On day two, what happens? Similarly, on day two, again, when the market opens, it opens with some strike price, not necessarily F of 1 comma T. It opens at some strike price and it changes every moment during the trading time. At the end of the day, say the future with the same expiry date closed with the strike price, say it is denoted by F of 2 comma T. Then again, F of 2 comma T minus the previous day, because it is set to the previous. What is the idea behind this is, initially you initiated the contract with this price and the exchange at the end of first day set it to this price. Therefore, according to this settlement, your current strike price of your contract is F1, not this. Okay. Therefore, you have to minus it by F1 comma T. Okay. F of 0 comma T is gone. Okay, on the first day when the money is adjusted in both the deposits, the difference in the price is adjusted in the deposits, that is the marginal deposit. Therefore, your new strike price is set to F of 1, comma capital T. Therefore, this is the money given to party A, and equivalently, this money has been given to party B. Okay, means what? If this is positive, if this amount is positive, it means party B's margin deposit is removed, is debited this much amount, and it, that amount is credited into margin deposit of party A. On the other hand, if this is negative, then that money is debited from party A's margin deposit and credited into party B's margin deposit. Like that, it goes on. Then day three, you take the closing price of strike price of the future. Again, F of 3, comma capital T minus F of 1, comma capital T went off. Therefore, your present strike price of the contract is this. That you will be transacting in the party A's margin account, and similarly 2 comma capital T minus F of 3 comma capital T is transacted from the party B's account. Like that it goes on. Okay, how long it goes? Either till expiration date, or one of the party exits the position, then this process is stopped for that party. The other party who has not exited will continue this process. Maybe its counterpart may be somebody else, say part C. Okay, so it goes on like that. So in this, when you remove money from margin deposit and put into the other deposit, obviously one deposit is getting decreased, other gets increased. If the future price is one-sided, like either it is always increasing for some time or it is always decreasing for some days, then one of the margin deposit account may go lesser and lesser day by day, right? Because you are always taking money from it because the price is one-sided. In that case, the margin deposit amount may go less than certain percentage, okay? Say 5%. Then your exchange will ask that party. Say, for instance, if B is always losing because the asset future price is always increasing, then since party B is a short position, so he will be always losing the money, and therefore his margin deposit will always be decreasing day by day. And if his margin deposit initially, which is 10%, has reduced to 5% and below, then exchange will contact party B and ask him to put some money to make it again to 10%. Okay. If he does, then this process will continue. If he denies to do that, then also exchange closes that person's position and settles the remaining deposit money to that person. So this is also one reason, one way that the process gets disturbed or closed. Okay, so this process is called the marking to market process. Okay, future is always get settled every day. Okay, then and there they will get settled. And in order to avoid the default of any one of these members, the exchange takes money from them, some amount of money from them, and keeps with it, and then make these transactions. Okay. That keeping the money with exchange is what is called deposit. And generally, this deposit doesn't earn any interest. Okay, it means exchange will not give interest on this deposit money. That is marginal deposit money. Okay. So let us illustrate this with an example. Let the party A and B went for a future contract on a share, say. So the quantity of the share is 600. And the strike price is, say, 1269.2, for instance. The day of issue is 1st of Feb, and the expiration is 25th of Feb. Okay. Since The quantity is 600 and the price, strike price is 1269.2. The exchange will take a deposit of, say, 10% of 1269.2 into 600. And that will happen to be, I think, 76,152. So party A will pay a deposit to the exchange and party B will pay the deposit to the exchange. Okay, with this, the contract starts on 1st of February, say at the market closing time. Say on the 2nd Feb, F of say 1 comma T. Okay, because it starts on 1st, so 0 corresponds to 1. 2 corresponds to 1, therefore it is F of 1 comma T, and say the price is 1278.85. That is on the 2nd February, the future price of the same asset closed at this price. Okay, then there is a difference because initially you had 1269.2, now the next day it was 1278. Therefore, 5,790 is the difference plus for 600 shares. Okay, it is so you have to multiply with 600, and that is given to party A. Okay, and equivalently, that amount is removed from party B's account. Okay, that is, this is minus 5,790. Okay, so you take that much money from here and put it into this account, okay, on the 2nd of February. Exchange will do that, and say on 3rd February, again it opens at some price and then it keeps on trading every moment during the day. And at the end of the day, say the strike price denoted by F of 2 comma T is, say, 1287.4, okay, then you have to subtract from F of 2 comma T minus F of 1 comma T. Don't subtract it from F of 0 comma T. That's wrong, okay, because by doing this transaction, you have set your current future price to F of 1 comma T. F of 0 comma T is gone from the scene, okay. So if you make the difference between these two into 100, into 600, okay, that will amount to, again, plus 5130. It means this much money is credited to party A and the equivalent money is debited from party B's margin account. Okay, so it means margin B, it means party B is losing money in this future trade. Then on 4th Feb, the price, that is at the end of the day, the price of one share in future, okay? Generally, the spot price and future price will be entirely different, okay? They will have some relation. We will see that later, but they are different, okay? What I'm quoting here is future price. On the 4th, it is, say, 1281.55, okay? So it means, you see, it has reduced. Here it is increased. Here also it is increased when compared to F of 0 comma T, but here it decreased, okay? Therefore, on that day, the margin deposit of party A will lose some money, that is 3510, and margin deposit of party B will gain some money. Who will give that money? From party A's margin deposit account, it is taken and put in margin deposit of party B's account. Okay, so on this day, margin B got some money. Then 5th February, say the closing price, strike price of the asset is 1277.5. Then again, party A lost and the same amount party B gained. Okay. 6 and 7 are holidays. So you have 8th February, Saturday, Sunday holiday. Therefore, market was not open. Then 8th February, you had again trade. At the end of 8th February, the price jumped to, okay. And that gave another jackpot for party A. And that has ruined party B. Okay. And like that, it went on. Okay. So this is the real-time data I have taken from the NSE site for Infosys. You can see that. Okay. If you would have entered this trade on 1st Feb, okay, that's a future trade. If you would have entered as a long, you would have gained money like party A. If you would have entered as short, you would have lost money like party B. Okay, what it means? If you would have had a contract where you will buy 600 shares, if you would have put the contract like that, I will buy 600 shares from somebody, okay, at the rate of this. It means you entered as a long position because you contracted as a buyer there. Okay, it's a long position. Whereas if you would have contracted by saying that I will sell 600, okay, then you would have taken a short position. Okay, then your margin account would have lost money like this, where if you would have taken a long position, you would have increased like this. Suppose party A thought, okay, let me close this position. Okay, then what party A will do is, party A on 9th February morning will again look for a contract, future contract, where party A will accept to sell 600 shares. Okay. Whatever may be on that day, 5F of 6 comma, 6 comma T. That it's not the end of the day. I should not put 6 comma T. So some price, because after the market opens, anytime during the trading day, party A may choose to exit the position. The moment the party A decide to exit the contract, the party A will simply initiate a contract where it will party A will write that I will sell 600 shares for whatever price at that time the future market is offering. Okay, say it may be 1,311 rupees, say for instance. Then that money will be taken as F of 6 comma T, and that will be subtracted or from this price, and that change, whether it is positive or negative, will be given to the margin deposit, and that total money will be given to the party A, and party A completely comes out of the future trade. Okay. Whereas party B, if the party B chooses not to exit, then this process will continue with the 9th February, and it will go on. Similarly, if party B wants to close the position, what party B will do is, party B will again on 9th or any day that party B wants to close the position, party B will issue a future contract or look for a future contract where the party B will buy 600 shares for whatever at that time the future market offers. Then the difference between the previous day and the price at which party B traded the opposite trade, that difference will be put in its margin account, and that will be given back to party B, and party B will go back to its house with that money. Okay, so this is how the contract will be closed before maturity. Of course, if they don't disturb this, this process will continue till the maturity date. And on the maturity date, anyway, if you see them on the maturity date, your future price will become the spot price. Okay, so that minus the previous day's future price will be given to both the, given or taken from the both the accounts. And then the margin account will be given back to the parties, and the parties will take it and go back to home. Okay, so this is how the future trade happens. Okay, with a concept called marking to market.